Okay. Call to order. Thank you. Earlier today, we had committee reports. And now I'll call the regularly scheduled meeting to order. First item on the agenda is our invocation rendered by Chaplain Amos Durham. Mr. Durham, good to see you today, sir.
Good to see you, sir.
Yes, sir.
I'll stand, please. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for all that you've done on this day. You provided for us and given us the strength we needed to make it to this point. We pray tonight for your presence in our meeting. Pray for each council person. Continue to endow them with your wisdom and leadership ability as they move forward this meeting tonight. And we pray your presence will be seen and heard. We thank you for the opportunity that you've given all of us to be citizens of Spartanburg County to make her a better place. Pray this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Bob Walker, would you lead us in the pledge, sir?
Yes, sir. Attention, salute, pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Bob. There are no presentations tonight, but I would like to take just a moment and recognize Justin Bradley and his wife for their 7th anniversary today. Justin, congratulations.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
David and Susan Britt celebrated their 40th anniversary on June 4th. So, David,
there you go. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
And Tony and Kathy Bell, they celebrated their 36th anniversary last week. So, great.
Mine's next week, Joe.
And Rogers is next week. He's on TV, so we got to get that in early. Rogers is next week.
6 weeks, right?
Yeah.
At least.
No other presentations, but we move to employee recognition, Catherine O'Neill. Catherine.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and the rest of council. I think I saw Judge Caldwell come in. Hi, Judge Caldwell. Welcome. I know that you're very proud of the recognition that I'm about to give to your employees that we talked. I had a wonderful opportunity to spend some time with Judge Caldwell and her staff on Friday. We were presenting service awards and catching everyone up. And listening to Judge Caldwell talk about literally the thousands of lives that her team impacts at sometimes the worst moment in their life, I know that this brings you special joy to know that this individual felt strongly enough that they wanted to let us know about what your team did. So without any further ado, Judge Caldwell, I'd like to ask Robin Salters, Karen Gray, and with Probate Court, and then Barbara Baker with the Assessor's Office. If you guys wouldn't mind. So, counsel, Dr. White, who's the pastor of Casey Creek Baptist Church in Chesney, wrote to express his gratitude for the way that county employees, especially these three, demonstrate their professionalism, kindness, and willingness to help. He was relieved with the ease and efficiency of the process after the recent passing of his mother, not just by one office, but by every office he visited. These three employees have handled his case with the utmost dignity and professionalism, and I'd like to ask you to join me in thanking them for representing us so well. I'm also looking forward to recognizing some elected officials at the next council meeting with council as well. I don't know that many of you know this, but Judge Caldwell is celebrating her 43rd year with Spartanburg County. And so we're looking forward to having all the elected officials here in an upcoming meeting to thank them for their service as we share the service award with them that you have brought to the county as part of our employee recognition program. So, Judge Caldwell, congratulations on 43 years of service. Thank you.
Thank you, Catherine. Next, we go to item 6, conduct public hearings. First is item A, to consider an ordinance authorizing the delivery by Spartanburg, South Carolina, a fee and lieu tax agreement by and between the county and Fortress Fiber, LLC, Project Fiber, anyone to speak on behalf of Project Item A, Project Fiber? None seen, close A, open B. To consider an ordinance to add an uncodified ordinance to the Code of County of Spartanburg to certify the Inman Mill facility as a textile mill site under South Carolina Textiles Communities Revitalization Act. Anyone to speak on behalf of Item B? None seen, close B, open C. To consider an application for special public event exclusion from the noise ordinance requested by Pedro Figuero on Saturday, July 1st, 2017, from 11 a.m. to 11:55 for a birthday party at 450 Old Converse Road. Anyone here to speak on behalf of Item C? None seen, close C, open D. To consider an application for special public event exclusion from the noise ordinance requested by Greer Dragway on July 22nd, 2017, August 19, 2017, August 26, 2017, September 2nd, 2017, September 16, 2017, October 7, 2017, October 28, 2017, November 4, 2017, from 4 p.m. until 11:59 p.m. for a drag race at 1792 Dragway Road, Greer. Anyone speak on behalf of Item D, if you would? Yes, sir, if you would, your name for us, please.
My name is Dale Goodrich. I own the Appalachian Mill, close to the drag strip.
Okay.
I would think it would be simpler for the dragway to commence their sporting event an hour earlier than run in an hour later. You know, there's people in the neighborhood that like to sleep. This runs into after 11 o'clock, and residents and children are usually in bed by that time. Dragway also creates additional noise for the neighborhood. I'd like to point out that the National Hot Rod Association adopted the ordinances or rules for their drag strips back in 2000. And they agreed at that time that they would add mufflers to their race cars, and that the maximum decibel level for drag strip cars at that time would be set for 95 decibels. And they had a standardized reading for measuring the decibel levels of race cars. And that was at a distance of 50 feet with the engine running at 3,500 RPMs, that they could not exceed 95 decibels. So, not only does the drag strip run unmufflered on Saturday nights, they also want to extend it into late hours where people are trying to rest and sleep. I would suggest, to resolve this whole issue, that they no longer even be able to submit a request to run extended evenings like this, and that the city council or the county council adopt some type of an ordinance where we can actually monitor and quantify what the sound level is coming from the racetrack. Then the neighbors and the racetrack can all be friendly neighbors, because we're all adhering to a set standard of regulations that can be quantified. Code compliance could come out, set up a meter. They can determine whether the cars are performing to this National Hot Rod Association standard, which is a national standard. It's also a standard set by Canada. So it'd be really simple for city council or county council to make a resolution to adopt the standard, no matter whether it's a Wednesday night, Thursday night, Saturday afternoon, Saturday evening, and would give us all some peace if we could adopt the standard by now.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Appreciate you being here. Anyone else? Yes, sir.
Good evening. My name is Dytone. I live within about a mile of the traffic. And I agree with everything Mr. Gregory said. I was actually put a decimeter on my phone so I could just get an idea just something I've had for probably 4 or 5 years. But on nights when they have the drag strip out there and they're really running loud, it gets worse. It gets worse for me. Now, I can go inside, but I live here. I should be able to go out and enjoy my backyard and not have to listen to the 90 decibels. On top of that, I also, if you read your own ordinance on noise, what is good for the people? What is good for families? That's not good for families. It's just not. So I'd just like to say I am opposed to having them run with no noise limits, and I'm opposed to having them run past their normal hours of, I think it's 10 o'clock, not even 11. So I would like to see this thing shut down completely so that we get back almost what he said. Does that make sense? Put some rules and some regulations behind it rather than him coming in every time he turns around. Now, one other thing I want to note that I did before I came in today. Because last time this happened, I didn't have a chance to come in and talk about it. But you're supposed to have it in publication so you can read and see when it's going to happen. I stopped at the Greer paper today before I came in here, and we went all the way back to, I think, the 24th of May, older editions since then, and there was nothing in their paper that we could find. I'm not saying that they didn't do it. I'm just saying the person at the newspaper and myself, we did not see it. So that would be another reason to stop. All right, and that's all I have, unless you have any questions.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Maybe we got a little, what have we got there? Not the review, but the publications was done.
It was in the Herald.
In the Herald Journal.
I was told that it was in the Greer Gazette. And I've been looking at it on a regular basis to see if it's there. And now all of a sudden, and it was in there for the main one, but it turns out it wasn't in there for this one. He has to follow the same process. He can't pick and choose what newspapers to put in.
Boy, just now, I'll make sure that we're open. This is filed. So the only one we do have filed for is June. Is that the way I'm reading? For the two times in June.
So,
do we have one that covered all the dates? Or what?
Mr. Walker, if you'll take a look at the ad itself, make sure it's in your agenda packet.
All right. Yeah, I know I had that there. That's him. Oh, I see what you're saying. Yeah, it's got the dates in the corner. Yeah, I see it. Right. It's the dates are there. Yeah, in the corner of the in the edit. That same guy. So.
Yeah,
right.
I understand that, but it wasn't in the one that we were told to look at. It wasn't in the rules. That's what I was told the last time that it was going to be.
The last time, whenever you sent those, we went and pulled those. And it was there. We had filed those last time.
You and I had that conversation. Right. One of the ones you said to do was the Greer Gazette, so that's what I chose to look at since I'm using Greer.
Right.
And I'm
not hopping
on. All right. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Don.
Anyone else? Your name, sir?
Mike Greer, Mr. Chairman, member of the council. I just want to give you a couple of facts about the racetrack. In August, we started our 59th year of operation, and been there a long time. In the past year, we had people travel to Spartanburg County from as high as 17 states to attend one of our events. So, we thought, I think we're helping the area, the economy. I don't have any problem being done 10 or 11 o'clock. Except during these hot months, we sort of try to be just consistent, make this ad simple. If you want to change back to 11 o'clock, I don't have any problem at all with that, except for July and August, it's just hot out. I don't think Mr. Keller or anybody else wants to be out in the middle of the day that time of year. I'd be glad to work with you on those times as much as we can. If anybody's got any glad to draw an answer.
Very much. Thank you. Anyone else? All right, that concludes D, and that concludes our public hearings. Earlier today, we had our committee reports. First Committee, Economic Recruitment and Development, Honorable David Britt, Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We have eight items before the committee heard and put before full council. The first item, the committee recommends that we render first reading to an ordinance designated and approving a sponsor affiliate, Magna Seating, in satisfaction of the requirements of Title 12, Chapter 44 of the South Carolina Code, so as to follow the to allow the sponsor affiliate to qualify for benefits pursuant to fee in lieu of ad valorem taxes in the arrangements with Spartanburg County. Mr. Chairman, I move that we approve on first reading.
We have a motion on A and A1 and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? I vote affirmative and it passes.
Next item, Mr. Chairman, committee recommends and I move that we adopt a resolution authorizing under certain conditions the execution and delivery by Spartanburg County, South Carolina of a fee in lieu tax agreement with Project Royale with respect to an industrial project in the county whereby the project would be subject to the payment of certain fee in lieu of taxes. Move that we approve on this resolution.
We have a motion on two and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? I vote affirmative and it passes.
Next item, committee recommends and I move that we adopt a we render first reading to an ordinance authorizing the execution and delivery of fee in lieu tax agreement by and between Spartanburg County and Project Royale.
Second. We have a motion and a second on three. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? I vote affirmative and it passes.
It's a point of interest, both of those items, Project Magna Seating Project and Project Royale are both BMW suppliers. Next item, we have a request, and I move that we adopt a resolution authorizing under certain conditions the execution and delivery by Spartanburg County, South Carolina of a fee in lieu tax agreement with Project Flex /NIA.
Second. We have a motion and a second on number four. Any other comments, questions? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? I vote affirmative and it passes.
Next item, committee recommends and I move that we render first reading to an ordinance authorizing the execution and delivery of a fee in lieu tax agreement by and between Spartanburg County, South Carolina and Project Flex NIA.
Second. We have a motion and a second on number five. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? I vote affirmative and it passes.
Next item, committee recommends and I move that we render first reading to an ordinance authorizing and approving the development of a joint county industrial and business park pursuant to section 4-1-170 Code of Laws of South Carolina 1976 as amended in conjunction with Spartanburg County, the park, such park to be at the time of its initial development geographically located in Cherokee County and to include certain property owned and operated by a company identified for the time being as Project Bulldog, or one or more of its affiliates, or other related companies. And number two, the execution and delivery of a written park agreement with Cherokee County as to the requirements of payments of a fee in lieu of ad valorem taxes with respect to park property and the sharing of the revenues and expenses of the park. Number three, the distribution of revenues from the park within Spartanburg County. We render first reading.
Second.
We have a motion on six and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? I vote affirmative and it passes.
Next item, committee recommends and I move that we render first reading to an ordinance to amend the agreement for development for a joint county industrial park, Wingo Industrial Park, by and between Spartanburg County and Union County, South Carolina, so as to include additional property in Spartanburg County as part of the joint county industrial park. Move that we render first reading.
Second.
We have a motion and a second on seven. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? I vote affirmative and it passes.
The last item, the committee recommends and I move that we render first reading to an ordinance to amend the agreement for development for joint county industrial park by and between Spartanburg County, Cherokee County, South Carolina, so as to include additional property in Spartanburg County as part of the joint county industrial park and other matters relating thereto. WCC Holdings, Wolverine Coatings, Advanced Ceramics, and Albus Plastics Corp.
Second.
We have a motion and a second on 8. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative, and it passes.
And real quickly, earlier during the committee meetings, I made a comment about today being the 25th anniversary when BMW made the decision to move to Spartanburg County. I think everybody in this room, almost everybody was here or in South Carolina at the time, and we know what a great decision that was. We went from losing 25,000 jobs to the demise of the textile industry. Today we've generated about 45,000, created 45,000 jobs. And that BMW announcement back on officially June 23rd of 1992 was a $300 million investment, which now has turned into a $9 billion. And they keep on investing in Spartanburg. And the team that's in this room, the citizens and the staff are responsible for that great growth. BMW is committed to Spartanburg. And all the suppliers, like I mentioned earlier, a couple of those earlier companies were suppliers. And they've helped us now, you know, create $16 billion invested here and over 45,000 new jobs. So this team that we have in the county and the leadership, you know, it makes a big difference in who we are and where we're going.
Mr. Chairman, I'll say a note, too. I know there's a lot of there's people that have some misconceptions about the fee and lieu that we do here, like we just went through about the last 30 minutes. Seems like going through these new projects. Just as an example, a lot of people question me about it. You know, I've heard the phrase, when is BMW going to start paying their fair share of taxes and things like that? In the school district, one of the school districts that I represent, and they're all getting different amounts of money, but District 5 has gotten $7.5 million from BMW for their taxes.
This past
just
year.
Just this past year. So that's every year, you know, in varying amounts between now and the last 25 years. They paid $15 million in property taxes. And so they're paying their fair share, and so when you listen to what council does here, we are just facilitating what the state should have been doing in the first place, which is make a reasonable tax rate for a corporation that comes in instead of the outrageous tax rate that the state set many years ago. It's not very competitive at all with any of the states that are around us. So Spartanburg County does what it does to bring jobs. And David and his group have done that for over 25 years. And we have BMW, who is literally floating all the boats in our area. And all these suppliers that come in, and they pay their fair share of taxes. And what they do for this county and the area is tremendous. So I just want to set the record straight a little bit about fee and lose. They're not the culprit that many people think they are. So.
Thank you, Roger. Anything else? Did we vote? Did we vote, Debbie Lou? Okay, thank you.
That concludes our committee report.
That concludes economic development. No items under public health. Next, we have personnel and finance. Honorable Bob Walker, Chairman. Mr. Walker.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First item, we recommend the receive information, take desired action in reference to a resolution calling for a public hearing to be held upon the question of issuance of not exceeding $2 million in general obligation bonds of the Croft Fire District, providing for the publication notice of such public hearing, and the committee recommends, and I so move, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, we have a motion on C1.
Second.
And a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative, and it passes.
Next item along the same line with the Croft Fire District is receive act information and take desired reference to an ordinance authorizing the issuing of general obligation bonds in the principal amount not exceeding $2 million, authorizing a referendum as a condition of such issuance. And the committee recommends this first reading in the ordinance, and I so move.
I have a motion, C2, and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, a vote affirmative, and it passes.
Next issue is receive information and take desired action in reference to a resolution amending the date of a public hearing to be held on the issuance of $6.5 million general obligation bonds in the Pelham-Batesville Fire District, providing for the publication of the notice. And the committee recommends adopt this resolution, and I so move.
We have a motion on C3.
Second.
Second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative, and it passes.
Next item, we received information, took desired action in reference to the Accommodation Tax Advisory Committee recommendation for the fiscal year 2018. The committee recommends that we approve this recommendation, and I so move, Mr. Chairman.
We have a motion on 4.
Second.
And a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, a vote affirmative, and it passes.
Next item, receive information, take desired action in reference to a resolution to adopt various county fee schedules so as to establish the amount of certain fees in Spartanburg County. The committee recommends this resolution, and I so move.
We have a motion on 5.
Second.
And a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, I vote affirmative, and it passes.
That concludes our report, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Walker. No items under livability. We go to public safety. Honorable Michael Brown, Chairman. Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We had two items that came before our committee. We had a presentation earlier today in which the Spartanburg County Communication Center was recognized in helping the Spartanburg County Fire Department achieve an ISO rating of Class 1. The information that we received at the time says this is a very difficult thing to achieve. And I think when we heard from the chief, it was a 0.08% that you would see in terms of someone of an area like Spartanburg receiving this. And so we were so very thankful that our communications department, which received a perfect rating out of the various parts to make this work, to receive a Class 1 rating, able to do that, and it's not seen that often. So I just wanted to point it out and thank Director Mike Flynn and his staff for all they do. Secondly, we received information and had a request to take desired action in reference to authorizing the commission of Ms. Ashley Pate, property maintenance officer, as a Spartanburg County Code Enforcement Officer. The committee recommends full council, and I move that we authorize the commission.
Second. We have a motion and a second on E2. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative, and it passes.
Those are the only items that came before the committee, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. No items under land use tonight. No items under public works tonight. Now we go to item 8, public comment period. And I did have some individuals signed up. We have public comment period. We have Mr. Masalas to speak. We have 3 minutes per person. So, Mr. Masalas, if you would, please, your name and address for us.
My name is Steve Masalas. I'm here to bless you today and thank you to allow me to work on the property or to give me the advice. Very scared. This better. I want to work with my food truck on the property all year round. Maybe you can change the law to allow me and everybody else to work at least 6 months a year in the property. And I have pictures here from the property, very inspicious papers. The new truck is built in and out. And manual. And that last week, I tried to drive on the property number 2, and my private van sink inside in the mud, and the tractor had to come and pull me out. Now, if I'm going to go to work with my food truck on the property number 2 or number 3, which is 500 feet back there, I'm going to get stuck up there. Property number 1 has gravel down on the floor. The other two properties, they don't have no gravel. So, about all of you to see if you can vote this very municipality here, allow me to work on my property, number 13491, Highway 417, Woodrow. I have family support, and I want to work. You want to see this paper?
If you would, Mr. Masalas, leave it with the county attorney right there, and he'll get it to all of us. Thank you, sir. Anything else?
That's all.
Okay.
I just want to work on my property, if you allow me, all of you here.
Well, thank you, Mr. Masalas. Is Terry Stansny here tonight? Hey, how are you, Terry? If you would, please come forward and your name and address for us. I may have mispronounced your name.
I'm Terry Stansny.
Stansny.
You need to know what my address?
655 Mount Vernon Lane is what I had. Okay,
that's
thank
right.
you. Okay.
Yes, I'm here to discuss smart meters that have been put on our homes by Duke Power. And the reason why I want to bring it to your attention is there is a lot of research showing that they cause health problems and Alzheimer's.
Oh, don't be nervous.
Health problems, and also there's a privacy issue. And it's so much so that other states are allowing an opt-out option, whereas our state is not offering. They're offering, like, you still have to get a smart meter, but it's a modified smart meter. And you have to pay $150 one-time fee and then $11.74 a month. The issue that I see is not what other states are offering, like Florida, Michigan, and a lot more states are offering, like, an analog meter, which is the safest, and a wired meter, which gives off no microwave radiation. And I'm just asking that we have a different option besides a smart meter. So that's basically, if y'all would please just look into the options, but we are definitely, as of right now, the only option is two types of smart meters.
Okay. Well, Terry, thank you for bringing that up. I know they called me a few months ago and said they were going to save me all this money, but they never told me about $150, 11 a month, so I better check my bill again. But anyway.
Well, it's $150 if you opt out of getting the.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Oh, I see what you're saying. Okay.
Two-way communication, which the power company can communicate with the smart meter, and the smart meter communicates with a transmitter, which goes to a cell tower, and there is lots of radiation coming from that.
Oh, okay.
That a lot of people are not aware of, but the research is there, and they're just not. If you want to opt out of that, they're charging you $100.
Okay, I understand.
For a modified smart meter, it's still a smart meter, but they say they're going to disable the radio transmitter. But it's not the same options that other states are giving.
Okay. All right.
Ask her who she's talked to.
At Duke?
Yeah. Have you talked with someone from Duke Power personally? I mean, or have they come out, or have you talked to anybody personally?
Yes, I have on several occasions. I even offered getting an analog myself and have an electrician put it in, and they told me they would turn my power off. So, yes, I've talked to them, and they said as of right now, they have the okay to just offer these two options of the different types of smart meters, the one with two-way communication, and then the one that they're going to disable.
Okay. Dave.
Is Lawrence Electric, Broad River, have you checked with those? Are they doing the same thing, or is it Duke just doing this?
I'm not aware.
Well, Lawrence Electric, they supply electricity on the southern end of the county.
I think Duke's the only one doing
it. So Duke's the only one? That was my, it's the first I've heard of it, and I'm a Duke subscriber, so I'm looking into it after this.
A lot of people I talked to have no idea what a smart meter is. They thought that I was coming to talk about meters, parking meters. So a lot of people are not aware.
Okay, well, I appreciate you bringing that to our attention. I need to look into mine more because that's on my house, I believe.
Yeah,
they called and asked me if I wanted it, said it was going to save me a lot of money. I said, okay, let's do it. All right,
yeah,
thank you. Appreciate you bringing it out.
Well, thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Next, we have Larry Cooper. Larry here tonight.
Yes, gentlemen. Larry Cooper. I live at 102 Winchwood, Spartanburg. My issue tonight is law enforcement or a lack of. I will have to tell you probably the South Carolina elites is either at the bottom of the list when it comes to fatalities. I think last year we were number one as far as what, number one. I say the bottom because the worst. And I'm not from here. So I'm not acclimated to the culture, let's say, per se. But the question I have, the first question is turn signals. I asked six different deputies from the county and a couple of gentlemen from the city why turn signal law is not enforced. I mean, it wasn't designed to hang rabbits foot on. And I got basically the same reply from every officer. Well, we never enforced that. You know how many people die because people not having the intelligence to use the turn signal, and how much funds you could raise from this? Another excuse: we don't have enough money to hire more officers. Enforce the law and hire more officers. Double yellow lines. Another example: you go out to fight the thug robbers. I guarantee you could write 100 citations between the morning and the evening rush hour for crossing a double yellow line. Nobody does this. You're losing funds, you're putting people's lives at stake. I mean, if the sheriff is more interested in winning his election than enforcing the law, we've got a problem. Next issue. This is back to the sheriff's department. From what I can gather, nobody seems to know how to interpret the law. Because every officer you talk to seems to have a different interpretation of this. Before I grew up and where I lived, different states. They usually have a law, and this is how it is. I have a situation with people urinating. I live on a golf course, and I called one of the deputies out last week, or 2 weeks ago, and because this has been going on since I built my house 12 years ago. And the deputy, and this is, we can, get a copy of the video from the sheriff's department. She said, well, a lot of elderly people, they can't hold it, they have to go. And I says, you don't have a urinating law in this state? She says, yes, but as long as you try to conceal yourself, it's okay. I mean, this is 2000, this is the 21st century. You just don't urinate in people's backyard. But this is one of the deputies actually said. And then the other reply was, well, the golf course was here before you were. I mean, this is a little backward. I don't care how you cut it. Do you have a law against public urination or do you not? Somebody want to answer that?
No, I'm not going to answer it.
You don't know the answer?
What did the sheriff say? What did the sheriff say?
Basically, what I just told you.
Okay.
I don't know if you know me. I'm sure a couple of guys were here 12 years ago. I'm the person that embarrassed you so bad that you actually hired the litter enforcement.
Okay,
Don Arnold said, you accomplished in 10 days what I couldn't accomplish in years. I'm not here to embarrass you. I'm here to listen to some obvious things.
All right, your three's up, Larry. Your 3 minutes. You were up about 40 seconds ago. Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Next, we have Walter McSherry. Mr. McSherry.
Thank you very much. I'm speaking here because a commission that established by the county council has made a report with respect to the construction of the courthouse that is to be paid for by an increase of 1 cent in the 1% in the sales tax. I wanted to bring to your attention some information that I saw firsthand that I believe you should receive before you take action on this recommendation, as I believe it is quite important, and it involves the future of our county. I have lived in New York City for 25 years, and New York City did what the county council is about to do. They raised the sales tax. The sales tax is raised to 8.25%. The 0.25% made people in New York City say it tax conscious. 8.25% is what did it. I saw what happened. I saw some of the finest stores in America go out of business. Arbach's, Gimbel's, the famous competitor to Macy's, B. Allman, Messing Company, Arnold Constable, Tiffany's stayed open only because they sold the jewelry in New York and had the customers pick it up at a mall in Short Hills, New Jersey. The New York tax authorities, on the other hand, said they're mailing empty boxes to New Jersey, which they were doing, and they were indicted for tax evasion. Macy's went through a bankruptcy. It was a tough bankruptcy because they had just faced the takeover the year before, and the investors in Macy's lost everything. But by myself, tried to survive the crisis in New York retailing caused by this sales tax. After 3 years, I gave up. He said, we have lost $23 million on this store. What had happened is the customers were no longer there. When the tax went in, people said, oh, New York, they're sophisticated people. They're well-educated people. They got a lot of money. They won't act like that just because of a small increase in their sales tax. But they did. I have here articles from the New York Times I'd like to give to you, and you read at your pleasure, in which they describe the situation. One of them says that New York retailing resembled a business war zone. At the same time, in New Jersey, they said, if you want to get into this shopping center,
Mr. Chair, you got 15 seconds to wrap it up.
Very crowded on a weekend that the Giants are playing Meadowlands. Don't even give it a try. What will happen here? We will have a higher sales tax than the sales tax in Greenville County. I can see what is going to come up. And I urge no action on this, on the courthouse, at least certainly not this year, until an alternative means of financing it is found. And I say this because I see what's going to happen. New York got exactly $0 from its sales tax increase. Spartanburg County is going to get $0 from its sales tax increase.
Thank you, Mr. McSherry. I'll let you go over, sir. Thank you. All right, that concludes our public comment period. Next, we get to old business. Item one, render third reading to a budget ordinance relating to the fiscal affairs of Spartanburg County by making appropriations therefore, levying taxes for fiscal year beginning July 1st, 2017 and ending June 30, 2018 to provide for budget control of said appropriation by Spartanburg County Council. Do I have a motion to render third reading?
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
We have a motion.
Second.
And a second. Any other discussion?
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to amend the budget ordinance and Appendix B of the fiscal year 2017-18 recommended operating budget as revised in the drafts that we currently have in front of us.
Okay.
Second.
Second.
We have a motion and a second on the amendment. Okay. Any other discussion on the amendment? What is the amendment?
got here. This is our...
Mr. Chairman, I'd be glad to go through the amendment. The most significant portion of the amendment would take $400,000 from the capital projects in the parks fund and move those to the general fund for the purpose of adding additional funds to salary increases in the sheriff's department. The net effect of that, as I understand it from council members who approached me about this option, would be to take any of the master deputies who are earning less than $46,000, so the master deputies, senior detectives, and corporals to $46,000. As council's aware, in the recommended budget, the entry-level deputy pay is recommended to go to $37,000 if a deputy has been with the county for less than 18 months. If a deputy has been with the county for 18 months or more, it would go to a minimum of $38,093 for our existing employees. So the amendment before you would take master deputies, senior detectives, and corporals to $46,000 if they're not already earning at least $46,000. There are a couple of other minor amendments in the draft before you. I would categorize those as Scrivener errors. We have some adjustments to some millages for fire service areas that were stated at a higher amount than they were supposed to be stated. We have a couple of titles, job titles that needed to be corrected. I think that it generally sums up the changes, but those are the major
ones. All right. Any other discussion?
You say this is a one-time?
Yes, sir. As I understand, the council members who have asked for some additional information about this particular amendment, this would be a one-time transfer from the parks fund to the general fund. In future years, that revenue would need to come from the general fund, either in the form of growth or a reduction in expenses. So at this point, the budget includes a little over $1 million in salary changes for the sheriff's department that would need to be incorporated into next year's budget. This would add around $400,000. So we're approaching $1.5 million that we'll need to make sure is incorporated into next year's general fund budget for the next revenues.
And what's the source to keep their revenues up or the salaries up for the next 5 years? Where are you going to get that money from?
Sure. So in the last 5 years, we've seen a steady growth with the county that has been at least $1 million, more than that in most years. So I'm anticipating that these funds would need to be made available through that growth in the years to come. Certainly as we've come out of the recession, we've seen our budget rebound to the level that we saw pre-recession in 2008. And of course, I understand that in trying to help council with finding this resolution, that means that I'm counting on that additional growth. If it's not sustainable, then there'll have to be a reduction in expenses to present a budget to you that's balanced.
But this year, we're not getting out of these funds out of any additional growth, except we're just taking from the capital projects.
So the $1 million that's already in the recommended budget did come from growth. So this additional $400,000 is coming from capital projects in the parks budget.
Any other discussion?
Mr. Chairman, if I can, Mr. McSherry, I took a sample from you and got a newspaper clipping of my own. This is a newspaper clipping that I actually found from 1967, so 50 years ago. And this handsome fellow that's on the front page here is actually my grandfather, who spent many years serving for our sheriff's office. And at the time of this newspaper clipping, actually is working for our county communications as well. So for me, this is personal. My family has had generations that have worked for our sheriff's office. And as this article points out, these guys don't sign up for the pay. That's not why they do what they do. They do it because they want to serve and they want to serve the communities, and we all get a return for that. And so, I'll be supporting this amendment because while it's certainly not as far as our gratitude should go for these men and women that put on the uniform, it certainly is appreciated. And so I certainly that message to them that, that they are appreciated, and so hopefully we'll put some dollars towards that as well.
Any other? Yes, sir.
I think what Councilman Bradley just shared with you and what our chairman and I guess all this board has talked about for the last couple of years or 3 years we've been on the council that long is we're at a crunch point as far as how we need to operate. And when you're losing $4 to $5 million a year from the state, that we don't have local government funds that's required by state statute, we're faced with decisions like this that we have to choose and say, okay, we have a serious problem in our law enforcement with getting recruits to even join us. And it goes back to us somehow not getting the point across to our state legislators, and I don't want to criticize them too much because I served a few years down there and I know how it is. But we're having to take our own taxpayer dollars and do things that the state should be doing for us, so consequently it comes against and hurts us in this area. And this is a prime example of where we are. Now, yes, we could go out and raise taxes, but we're asking, and Mr. McSherry is sharing his thoughts, that we got to build a courthouse. So we can't ask for everything at one time. There's a statute in the state that says that we're entitled to CPI plus growth every year. This council prudently has sit, I guess since 2008, 2009 when that started, has not gone that route. But people have got to share with us that if that's what we need to be doing, we need to be seriously looking at it. So I'd share it with you, Councilman Brown, is we're at the crunch point. This year, Ms. O'Neill has been able to do what we asked her to do. And it's a tough point that we're faced with. So consequently, the people we're asking you, okay, you need to start coming to us more in these meetings and when you're out on the street or whatever and say, okay, what's important to you? It may come to a point that we can't do some of the things we want to do. As long as Councilman Britt's committee continues to bring the economic development, and we're fortunate. This county is a leader in the state of doing things, and we've been fortunate we haven't raised taxes these years. But it's tough right now, and that's the decision we made that we would, here again, our premises start with is to help those law enforcement, so at least we've got somebody to answer your call when you call that you need help at your home. So I applaud our leadership, our administrator and the staff, and I applaud this council as far as what we've done. But it's going to be this is some tough times. It's not, you know, we've got to be prepared for what's in the future.
Anyone else?
Mr. Chairman, just a minute, and I think you know Councilman Walker, he's hit the nail on the head, as did Councilman Bradley and Nutt. And I don't want to, you know, just beat a dead horse to death, but it's time. I mean, I look out in the room and I see a lot of folks that aren't in the Sheriff's Department, you know, staff people that work in every section of our county. And it's a travesty how one person can hold up the local government fund. I mean, you know, the chairman, Jeff and Catherine, you know, and a lot of us have gone to Columbia. We've lobbied to try to get this. And it means about $25 million that's actually the citizens of Spartanburg have had to come up with, and it's cost the employees because they haven't been able to get raises. Brian White, chairman of Ways and Means Committee in Anderson, because of his disdain for county governments, was told this past month, after we had our last council meeting, you know, by our own delegation members, that, listen, we support the local government fund, but until the chairman of the Ways and Means Committee gets off his problem with the counties, it ain't going to change. So we're going to have to do something. Councilman Brown, you were asking, what are we going to do between now and next year? You may have struck a chord with me, or you have struck a chord with me on what we're going to have to do. And we're going to have to change some thinking down in Columbia or get some people changed out of there. Because it is a shame. Again, I think it's a tragedy, a travesty, how one or two people in Columbia can dictate to 172 others what's going to happen across 46 counties. and you're impacting over 4.5 million people, and it's got to stop. And we got to do something between now and next year. Decisions are made in early January, even in December, what's going to happen to every one of us. And Councilman Walker spent 16 years down there. He knows how it is. But for one or two people in Columbia, a senator and a House member, to cause us not to be able to give every person in this room some type raise is wrong. So let's put our thinking caps on real soon and see what we're going to do to change Columbia.
Anyone else?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
Ms. O'Neill, with the amendment for the deputy pay, the deputy that will not be affected, what percentage raise will they get this year?
So, Councilman Farr, the recommended budget includes a 0.5% adjustment for all county employees who were not otherwise impacted by council compensation plan deductions. The point of that 0.5% is that council asked to blunt the impact of the employee's contribution to the retirement system, which is going up. So any employee at the Sheriff's Department that is otherwise not affected by either the recommended budget or the amendment that's being discussed here would receive 0.5% increase in July. Okay. If the budget's approved, as it is.
And as a new council member, I'd also like to go along with what's been said tonight. The state has put us in a major hurt in a lot of ways with the local government fund. I will be voting for this amendment tonight, but I believe this is only the beginning step of further helping our deputies as well as looking into other ways to help out our other county employees as well. So.
Okay, anyone else? All right. All those in favor for the amendment, raise your right hand. All opposed? And I vote negative as well. Thank you.
Jeff.
Now,
do we want to take an ad hominem in here?
Do what now?
Do we want to make, we'll take a motion to amend it to add that?
Yeah. David's got that. Mr. Britt, you want another budget amendment?
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion to amend the budget ordinance as presented at second reading to correct the millage rates for MN Community and UNA FSAs to adopt Appendix B of the fiscal year 2017-18 recommended operating budget as revised in the draft before us and adjust the revenue and expenditures accordingly.
Is that the correct one?
And that's the first one. I have another one, too.
Sure. So, Councilman Britt, I think that the motion that you have actually would
count
council out.
Oh, the other one? Or scratch that one. Don't second anybody.
You want to go out back?
Okay.
You want to go out back, fight this one out?
How about number two?
So I think that there was an additional amendment that council had talked about for the budget. What we would need to do, once we finish with the amendments.
The CIP budget amendment.
I think that's the next item on your agenda.
So hold off.
It would be important at some point once the amendments are completed to then have council vote on the budget as amendment.
Right. You're correct. But that amendment he's making was in the other amendment, right?
That was my understanding.
Based on your explanation, I took it that the UNA and the Inman community was in the same motion.
Yes,
That one would be necessary.
All right.
Well,
draw my motion.
It's going to
include the adjustment
in the deputy.
Okay. So we've made an amendment. Now
we've got to vote on
the budget.
You can still have another amendment right now, but once we finish the amendment, we would vote on
I thought we had one more to make, but obviously I was wrong. Now I need a motion on the third reading of the budget itself.
So moved.
No.
As amended.
As amended.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
A motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, I vote affirmative and it passes. Item two, render third reading to a budget ordinance to establish capital projects budgets for 2017-2018 budget year of the 5-year capital improvement plan.
So moved.
Second.
Have a motion?
Now, second. I do my budget amendment, right?
Okay.
To the capital improvement budget ordinance.
So the capital project budget amendment is intended to take the money from the parks project.
projects and move that to the general fund. So if your motion is to move those funds to the general fund, then that would be the only amendment that would be needed for the capital improvement plan budget.
Okay. So we got third reading up. We might have had a motion and a second. Now, David does his amendment here. Is that what you're saying? David, come up with your amendment right there.
I move to adopt the capital projects budget as presented at the second reading.
As amended.
All right. So this is where the money moves from parks over to general fund.
No. We need to do this. We need to do that right there.
Oh, yeah.
You do it.
You got the wrong one.
I don't know who gave me what.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to amend the capital budget as revised in what Catherine described in the moving of the $400,000 into the general fund to accommodate what we did in the original budget.
All right. We have a motion to amend the CIP, and this is to move the $400,000 over from parks over to general fund on this amendment. Any other discussion?
So you're saying you voted on the vehicle at first and now you're giving fuel to it, or is it vice versa?
Well, and I'm sorry, counsel. It was in going into this, I'll take responsibility for the confusion on the motions. As I understood it, there was a desire to amend the budget to move $400,000 from parks to the general fund. That meant that the capital improvements plan budget and the general fund budget both had to be amended. I didn't know if that amendment would be successful, so we prepared for you an alternate amendment that would allow you the option to approve the budget as you saw it at second reading. So I apologize for the confusion. If your desire is to amend the capital improvements plan budget to move $400,000, and I believe, I didn't hear the whole motion, but I believe that Councilman Nutt's motion, as long as what I think you intend, so that for the record we can clarify it, that you're amending the capital projects budget as revised in the draft that was prepared for council this evening.
Correct.
Then I think that's the only motion that you will need for the CIP. And again, I apologize. We were trying to prepare.
I got
for
you.
A
so one had one right, one had one wrong. Okay. So, item two, this is the amendment to move the money from Parks and Recs over to the general fund. Amendment. Any other comments? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? I vote negative. And it passes. Now, I render third reading to the budget ordinance to establish the capital project budget for 2017-18 budget year of the five-year capital improvement plan as amended.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? Vote negative. Passes. Item three, render third reading to an ordinance authorizing the execution and delivery of a fee agreement by and between Spartanburg County, South Carolina, and Senator International Freight Forwarding LLC, Project Senator.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? Vote affirmative, and it passes. Item four, render third reading to an ordinance amending the terms of a fee and lieu tax agreement by and between Spartanburg County and Spartanburg Rehabilitation Institute.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second on item four. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative, and it passes. Item five, render third reading to an ordinance authorizing the execution and delivery of a fee and lieu tax agreement by between Spartanburg County and Albus Plastics.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion on five and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative, and it passes. Item six, render second reading to an ordinance authorizing the execution and delivery of a fee and lieu tax agreement by and between Spartanburg County and Fortress Fiber LLC.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second on six. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative, and it passes. Item 7, render second reading to an ordinance authorizing the Pelham Baseball Fire District, South Carolina, to issue general obligation bonds in one or more series, providing for publication of said notice and findings, the already proven matters thereof. Item 7.
So moved.
I have a motion.
Second.
And a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative and it passes. Item 8, render second reading to an ordinance to add an uncodified ordinance to the Code of County of Spartanburg to certify the Emma Mill facility as a textile mill site under South Carolina Textile Communities Revitalization Act.
So moved.
Have a motion?
Yes, so moved.
And a second.
Can I ask a question? Does this finalize everything that we need for Emma on theirs, or we got more? Another reading or another item?
Another
John just finished
it. Councilman Walker, there's still a little more reading of this ordinance.
Right, thank you. Yeah.
All right, we had a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative, and it passes. New business, to consider an application for special public event exclusion from the noise ordinance requested by Pedro Figuero on Saturday, July 1st, 2017, from 11 a.m. to 11:55 p.m. for a birthday party at 450 Old Converse Road, Spartanburg. Do we have a motion?
So moved.
We have a motion. We have a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, to vote affirmative, and it passes. Need a motion to consider an application for special public event exclusion from the noise ordinance requested by Greer Dragway on July 22nd, 2017, from August 19, 2017, August 26, 2017, September 2nd, 2017, September 16th, 2017, October 7, 2017, October 28, 2017, and November 4, 2017. From 4 p.m. until 11:59 p.m. for a drag race at 1792 Dragway Road, Greer. Do I have a motion?
Motion.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
I'd like to, I was hoping that the two gentlemen that spoke would stay, but they didn't stay.
There's one man back there, gentleman back there, I think.
No,
they're both left.
They're gone.
I saw them later.
All right. What I'd like to, I'm going to make an amendment to what we have, but I'm going to ask you, Mr. Chairman, I'm going to try to pull everybody together. I'm not familiar. I know 57 years ago, when I was a senior in high school, the Greer Dragway was running then, and I know it's been in that community for a long time, and I don't want us to penalize people that's been in the community. But I don't want people that's moving in to come in and pretty well say what y'all decided. This was decided when, when did we do the ordinances that would deal with this? It's been what?
1995. My first year on here.
Yeah, right. It's been around, so it's not something that's new. But here again, we got new people moving in, so I'm going to try to work on the side. What I'd like to do is ask that we amend the motion, amend the application, leave July the 22nd, August the 19th, and 26th at the time requested, but all the other dates, move them back to 11 p.m.
Mike said that he didn't have a problem with going to 10 or 11. Yeah. I'm telling you, if I lived out there, and I was part of that problem back when it blew up. I mean, not any residents have fussed about it until now. But if I live near there, I mean, I live near a busy road, Pine Street, and you try to go to bed at 10:30, I mean, that's late for me. And on a Saturday night, 12 o'clock at midnight, that's too late, Mike. I mean, people have children, you're running jet cars, you don't have mufflers on them. I mean, it's a different time than 1957. It's a different time than 1995. The community, especially out in that area, is growing. And I think to put 8 dates on there all the way out into November, you talked about the heat, it's not hot in October and November. I think you're pushing to try to get 8 dates is a problem to me. Coming here once a month or whatever, I think that's fair, but 12 o'clock at night is way too late. And these folks that live out there, they have a right to be able to enjoy their property. So I think, Bobby, I think you got an idea. Work with them. I still think giving a bunch of dates at 12 o'clock on Sunday night, or Saturday night, is way too late.
Yeah. Well, I think there was some thoughts about where you do want to get it over with and all that. And that, David, I mean, I'm not disagreeing with you. And last Saturday, just to give an example, he didn't have an exemption. And it rained, and he had to cancel. So the rain is a problem in the summertime, and that's the reason that he's trying to, showers will pop up. So, like I said, I'd say we leave the three in July and August as they are and change the others to, is there any, Mike, can you do it any earlier than 11, 10:30 or so?
Mr. Barker, once I get to October, November, 10 o'clock's fine with me.
10 o'clock's enough then, or?
Can you live with 11 during the summer?
Well, let's leave. We'll leave you at 12 o'clock or 11:59 is what you asked for, is in July and August, and then go to back to 10 o'clock the rest of
them. I'd like to have 11 in September and October, November.
Do you need 11 in July? Or
no, he's
can
got
you
to
do
help.
11 or
I'd like to have 12 in July and August.
I'm not planning on being there that late. You get a little shy of rain or something, I'm not late. You need midnight, you need 11:59 in July and August, 11 in September and 10 October and November. Now Bob, was that your motion? I forgot it by now. Well, that's what we decided. Yeah, July and August, you'll stay at 11:59. September is 11 o'clock. October and November at 10 o'clock. Back to, that's your normal time, right? You don't have to have an extension.
Well, even the extension we got, we've been able to get out by about 10 o'clock. And I'm going to continue to try to do that.
Right.
You have people sometimes travel 12, 14 hours to get there.
You better be thinking about the neighbors out there. Forget about the people driving 12 or 14 hours. You got thousands of people. You're talking about this auditorium being filled up. When they find out, I mean, that's why I'm just trying to give you, Mike, some advice. Try to work with those folks. Do what you can live with, because you're getting ready to stir hornet's nest up. You watch.
Yeah. All right, so Bob, Bob's amendment. Do we have a second on Bob's amendment to the operating hours?
Second.
Now, any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, I vote affirmative and it passes. Thank you. Now need a motion to approve as amended. Do I have a motion? We have a second.
Second.
Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, I vote affirmative and it passes. Thank you. That concludes new business. Now under miscellaneous.
Can I make a motion on the other, the holiday?
I'm getting there, Bobby.
I'm sorry.
Miscellaneous.
You go for the miscellaneous.
Jumping the gun.
No, that's okay.
All right, under miscellaneous, do we have anything on the miscellaneous budget?
I didn't know where you had played.
We have anything under miscellaneous budget, council matters, other than BARs? Bob.
All right. Mr. Chairman, I would like to move that we add one more holiday for all the county employees.
You mean a floating holiday?
A floating holiday, not a designated, be a floating holiday that all of the county employees can take and add another one to their schedule.
I'll second that.
We have a motion and a second to add a floating holiday to county employees.
Mike says he wants five more holidays.
We have any discussion?
Is it paid all that?
We didn't say anything about that.
Any other discussion?
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, ma'am.
Because this is coming up under miscellaneous matter, can I ask Councilman Walker to change his amendment to direct the county administrator
That's my motion, Mr. Chairman.
All right, we have a motion that we ask the county administrator to allow a floating holiday. Do we have a second
to the amended?
Okay, we have a second by Mr. Nutt. Any other discussion? All in favor of the amendment and the BAR resolutions, raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative, and it passes. I need approval of the minutes of May 9, 2017, May 11, 2017, May 22nd, 2017. So I have approval of the minutes on those 3 days. Have a motion. We have a second. Second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative, and it passes. Thank you for your attendance. Need a motion to adjourn. Thank you very much.